see if I'm I am No, I knew.
Does that need to roll up?
No. No, we can see this into the TV. That's the main thing. But, you know, so I noticed last Sunday you're playing left-handed. No big deal.
Yeah, you can aim.
And then I saw the scripture written backwards. I said, oh, that's somebody said to ask me something nice.
And that's a good point. Because the phone was, yeah.
So I turned it. I didn't want people to have to see that, but that's okay.
Yeah.
So anyway. Sunday.
And I said, sure, got a car. And he says, I have to quote this. Thanks, Terry. You're a chump. And then he takes right back, right back, and says, dang, autocorrect. And you never know. I mean, you can't say no to the pastor.
Yes, you can.
You know, because the pastor's up a notch. You get a little closer to God. And if you say no to God,
that's right.
Anyway, well, we're happy that we have this place to come worship while we are renovating our church due to the flood. So we have a few announcements to take care of. One is a temporary service. I assume it's up, and that's a bad thing. I guess we used to have a big TV in the back of the church. I can see everything. But I can't just turn around.
Yeah.
Okay, so we are having our temporary services here for several more weeks. And we're just so appreciative of this, for this facility. Brand Memorial Service will be on the 17th at 11 o'clock, and that'll be at the Village United Methodist Church. They've been so gracious that we can schedule it there. And then the family will have a ceremony out at the Memorial Garden in our church, this family home. Women's Bible Study will meet at Rita's House Wednesday at 1 o'clock. You'll see that we have some Easter hams, the men's groups cooking up a few hams. So first come, first serve, they're going to be a hot item, I'm sure. So there's two different prices. It's in your newsletter to get the order form and everything like that. This past week we fed the boys club spaghetti, and when I got there to pick up the empty, lit to the bottom empty roaster, I still saw, I actually got me one of those brownies. They love that. And we even had extra joy there because I planned on doing this week before last, and I went ahead and bought cookies. So we had those bought cookies, and they're not bad. I mean, trust me. Yeah, I ate a couple. But we sent those home with a lot of the kids at the Boy Scouts. So that worked out really well. So we're so appreciative of the people who do the baking and for the ones donating the time to serve these kids, because it's so crucial. Today, after the service, we need help from a few men, if you will. All the chairs except around the table, we need to stack up. And if we'll just stack them about four high, then we'll move them up to the front. They have some other things going on this week.
So you're discriminating against the women helping?
No,
I don't know. We don't count now.
We need lots of straws. So that.
That's good.
I got one more. Mission House. Food pantry. That's it for January and February. So we'll continue with that. You can bring items here. And we'll take someone. I'll take them and drop them off at the church if you'd like to do that. Or just stop by the church. It's good if you can stop by. They finally cleared out everything that they were working on. And those folks did a tremendous job drying out the church, cutting holes in every places. And there's plans in process on getting the renovation work done. Stand up. Oh, yes, sir.
This February, we're not going to be here, so somebody's going to have to fill in that Boys and Girls Club to serve food and, you know, get the people organized.
Right.
And also pick up the cookies for church.
Pick up the cookies for church. That'll be on the 21st, yes, sir.
Men's breakfast.
Men's breakfast. Next Saturday, we're not cooking at the church. We're meeting at Deborah's. Women can do it. That sounds like pretty good. We'll meet at 7:30 at Deborah's this coming Saturday. Thanks, Mary.
We can't help if you guys are club murderers. Happy and Foot will be at my house on Tuesday at 1 o'clock.
And what's the
Foot?
And Me and Foot will be at Pam's house
Tuesday
at 1 o'clock. That's right for Facebook. I know everybody heard. Right?
I'll spend the day at the
world. Anybody else? Please stand, let's wave at one another, and we'll get to rock and roll.
Responding, is it okay?
make sure I know what's next.
All those texts I get to hear about.
What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. You see listed the names on our prayer list. Cindy and Doug are on there. I thought I added them, but I'm positive. We need to keep them in our prayers. And there's so many in our So, are there additional people that we need to lift up in prayer? Yes?
A blessing to Ashley Smith, so you can take that off the prayer list. She's all healed up. The tumor in her neck, they got that, and they fused her neck.
Ashley Smith, back to work. Coming off the prayer list.
Amen.
You need to keep adding her prayers. He's having a procedure. Is it this week?
Yeah,
Tuesday. Coming up this week, Tuesday, Ted in our prayers. Ted and Carol are traveling somewhere. Pat and Shade and them, they're cruising out here somewhere. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Father, you're just awesome. We serve an awesome God. And we are so thankful for the blessings that you've given us. We see it in our church, even now, that we're not actually sitting there. That church blesses us so beautifully. And we are so thankful for the leadership team, leadership of our pastor, Brother Doug. We are just in awesome presence when we gather together. As we gather together here, and just to hear the excitement that's in the air, we ask you, Father, to. There's lots of sickness going on, lots of flu and COVID going on. And we ask you to just heal those and bring them back to us in a timely manner. Father, we pray for our community. We pray for our nation that revival comes to our nation. We're thankful for the many gifts that you've given each of us, and we say thank you, God, for this day. Now we pray the prayer that you taught Jesus and his followers to say, saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we get prepared take up our offering, let's bless us. Most gracious Father, we are thankful for the gifts that you give us, and we are gracious that we can share in your kingdom with our giving. And the gifts of our talents that we see all through our community, be with this, this tithe and to the use of your children, Mountainside Church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
a lot of this song, taking it to the Lord in prayer. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. You know, a lot of times I saw something when there's worship music, and there was so much of, I guess it was this week I saw it, just talking about the music and how it takes a song from being worshipful to can really cause it to be not as worshipful. Just depending on what instruments are played or things like that. And it got me thinking there's so much to the lyrics also, which we all know. But to somebody who doesn't, it's like, how do I take something to God in prayer? I don't know what to say. Well, the great thing is sometimes you don't have to say anything at all. Just sit in that peace, that silence, that stillness. So I think there's a lot to be said as I started this song, just listening to the music. For me, but as a musician, I think that's easier to do, you know. But I find a lot of solace, a lot of peace, just playing, just singing. So, this week, take the songs you listen to, the lyrics you hear, encourage you to take those, even if it's just a verse of a song that you hear, take it to God and pray about it. Even if it's just playing, I don't know, but you'll be amazed at how lyrics can change meanings when you bring God into the equation. Like you're reading the passage, right? So let's sing a song, "What a Friend We Have to Use."
What a friend we have. Trials and temptations.
that last line. Rapture, praise, and endless worship will be our sweet portion there. So take it to the Lord in prayer.
When you try to come up with a message, you start out, I had like 27 pages. Now, luckily that I had to make it big so I could see it. And I started weeding it down from there, scratching out this and that and the other. Doug says, I was going to preach out of the scripture in Matthew. I said, can I have a little more information? I said, yeah, Matthew 17. So that's why in the bulletin, I think it does say Matthew 17, 1 through 23. Because this was Wednesday. Stacy's got to have this information on Wednesday to get it in the bulletin, get it in the newsletter to send out things like this. So she says, Stacy says, what about a picture? I said, I'll find one. So, you know, when you're serving, it's last minute. Our passage this morning is certainly about unclean spirits that Jesus deals with because his disciples could not. This passage is primarily about the power of the person of Christ and what faith and reliance in him means to those who trust him and for those who lack faith in him. Hear these words that are printed in Matthew 17. Matthew 17, verses 14. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. Oh, unbelieving and perverse generation, Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon. It came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in pride and asked, why couldn't we do that? Why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, because you have so little faith. And I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say this to the mountain, move from here to there. And it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. When they came to gather in Galilee, he said to them, the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him. And on the third day, he will be raised to life. And the disciples were filled with grace. And God have blessed them with the reading of his Holy Scripture. Hopefully, I'll bring 3 points. And the first one being the power of Jesus, the power of faith, and the promise of pardon. Jesus has just come down from the Mount of Transfiguration. It's the next day. He, with Peter and James and John, all 3 Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, place this story right after the Transfiguration. The closer Jesus moves to his death and resurrection, the more his uniqueness is pronounced. You can see the contrast between what is certainly a glorious event in the Transfiguration. Can you only imagine in that Transfiguration of the disciples that were with him? They couldn't even, they had to cover their eyes some. And here they come trouncing down from the mountain, feeling good, man. Jesus is feeling good. And the only way I can picture it, kind of, is when you go on vacation and you have fun on your vacation and you come back and you got to go to work on the capsule. That they come off of this mountain and he's right back into the life that's being lived on. In verse 14 that we read, they come to the crown, the Father comes kneeling before Jesus. This would have been out of humility and desperation more than worship. Look at his words in verse 15. Lord, have mercy on my son. He has seizures and is suffering. He often falls into the fire and water. As you read this, especially we as parents and or grandparents, you can't help but be overwhelmed. What a heartbreaking situation in the fact that his son is in constant danger and repeatedly harmed because he has a spirit causing the symptoms of epilepsy. He's thrown into the water. And we can presume that the only thing that's really kept him alive is his parents. And that's why we're parents and grandparents. It's important to note the distinction between in the authority given to its disciples. In Matthew 10, 1, it says they have authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The two are distinct and separate. It just so happens that this desperate man in verse 14 is the father of a boy who is affected by both. And the real point is in who the Father brings his son to. He comes pleading for mercy on behalf of his son to Jesus. Best decision he ever made. And so it is for every parent. We must bring our children to God in prayer and plead for them. Now, I don't know about you, but there's lots of times when we were raising our kids, we would say lots of prayers. You know, and I gotta say, appearing in my sidekick, this is the first time in 14 years that we got to sit together.
Still talking.
And I appreciate it. I know she does. But we have to pray for them. You know, we got to keep praying. And now. Many of us have grandchildren, and you want the same for them. We should plead for his help, for their help, on their behalf, just like this father did. He's a good example for us. He brings them to Jesus because Jesus is a disciple. Even though they were given the authority, they couldn't help the boy. And I really wonder, when they were trying to rid this boy, you know, I kind of make things up. I said, are they saying, leave this body? Please, God, take this. I had no idea. I think back sometimes when I see something like this, I used to watch Bewitched, you know, and I think of the little girl Tabitha, yeah. You know, when she was trying to do some stuff, she had to put her finger on it, and they were probably doing something like this, you know, if that would work. And I think, I don't do make-believe too well, but Superman, I watched some of them shows, and there was a guy or a lady that could shoot fire out of her finger, and one of the guys with her would try, and he'd go zzz, and he'd come out about that far. You know, so they're trying to do something. And they were desperate because they knew this. So, and they didn't understand why they couldn't. The text says bringing, in 17 and 18, the text says, bring him here to me, and Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and the boy was healed instantly. The father and the boy are helpless. The nine disciples, all they were trying, are helpless. And Jesus, the Son of Man, God in flesh, intervenes. He cast out the spirit, and once again, healed instantly. This is mercy, compassion, and power of Jesus Christ, the God-man at work. He's one who nothing is impossible for. He has dominion over sickness, death, and demons. Which is exactly what happens here. Sickness and spirits obey the Son. We see the power that's just revealed in the three disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration the day before, displayed instantly, healing the boy, Jesus, the all-powerful Son of God. And isn't it amazing that Jesus, after just revealing his true glory, comes down to the broken world, and that helpless father immediately shows compassion to him. Rather, compassion for the hurting became an expression of his glory. And the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst, and we have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son of the Father, full of grace and full of truth. There is power and mercy and compassion of our God. Do we hear this as a church? How can we not entrust ourselves to him? Verse 16 basically says, you know, they could not heal him in the latter part of 19, could not cast it out. They were unable. They didn't have the power. Jesus responds to their failure in two different areas. I feel like I'm going to roll all the way up to you guys. Two areas. One is public and one is private. When he hears that his disciples couldn't cast out the spirit, his answer in verse 17, O faithless and twisted generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him here to me. This is the public rebuke. To whom? Is he rebuking the disciples? Is it the crowd? Is it the Jews? Is he talking to the Gentiles? I think the answer is yes. Yes. It's in part directed to the disciples because they lacked the faith to do something that Jesus had already given them the authority to do. It's not that they have no faith. It's that their faith is little. And it's the wrong kind of faith. The idea is that there's a fundamental imbalance what they, as a generation that was put to us, have put their faith and trust in. Jesus extends to all who are guilty of unbelief. To all who are guilty. Jesus' humanity shines through. Oftentimes we forget that God's walking around on sinful, gross, whining, complaining, angry, thankless, heartless people. People like you and me. God is living among them. He's eating with them. He's touching them. He's talking with them. He's healing them. He's raising them from the dead. He's controlling the weather that's in front of them. He's feeding them with many miracles. And he regularly, he's not being worshipped. Now consider Jesus, the Son of God, living among us. Simple humanity. We don't really know how evil they living amongst us, and the people, they don't even realize how evil they are. I'm bearing with you. How long am I going to bear with you? Is he getting exasperated? Is the exasperation of God living among the people who love the fact that he can heal, feed, raise the dead, but don't love enough to worship? In fact, they despise him. They're going to reject him. They're going to kill him. Faithfulness, righteousness is dwelling among them. He is surrounded by faithless people who don't know how bad they are. They don't get it. They don't know who he actually is. So in the, that was the public rebuke. In the primary rebuke, the disciples come to him and say, why can we not cast it out? And Jesus says, because of your little faith. What's going on here? Is this little as in quantity? I don't think so. Jesus says to them that if they have a little faith, like a grain of a mustard seed, and you say, move the mountain, move it from here to there, nothing is impossible. What a promise. It only takes a little bit of faith. The thing he's rebuking from them is for the quality of faith. You don't have to be full of faith. It just takes a little bit. He's rebuking them for the quality of the faith. It's not as in small. It's little as in poor. It's the faith the disciples have is little, weak, poor, because of where their faith is placed. Jesus used the phrase with them, but now, and it's interesting that you hear this quite often. In Matthew 6:30, O ye of little faith. Matthew 8:26, why are you afraid, O ye of little faith? Matthew 14:31, O ye of little faith, why did you doubt? Matthew 16:8, O ye of little faith. Faith is focused on what they don't have. Just one off the top, you know, they have the 5,000 and they're feeding them and these, and they're saying, we don't have enough food for these people. O ye of little faith. Faith that trusts God and expects him to work. I think it's clearly emphasized the fact that Matthew specifically contrasts the misplaced faith of the disciples. If only they had the faith of that father. Because he believed. Now, to us as the church, we work in the kingdom. The work of the kingdom is to be done in faith. Dependence on the true God. If we're not committed in setting ourselves to pray, you know, and when I saw that, you know what popped into my mind, Brother Doug, we're a praying church. We pray for the ones on our left, and we pray for the ones on our right. We are a praying church. And we have to trust in him. And the last thing that it talks about is there's a promise of pardon. In Matthew 17:22, as they were gathering in Galilee, Jesus said to them, the Son of Man is about to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And he will be raised on the third day, and they are greatly distressed. This is the second time that Jesus had predicted and promised the disciples that he would soon suffer and be killed. In verse 20, it says, about to be. Not only be crucified, but he will be delivered into the hands of men. In other words, he will be betrayed, delivered. And he will be raised on that third day. His betrayal and death are certain, but so is his resurrection. Why is Jesus repeating himself? When he said this, he said it in the last chapter, it's because disciples need to be constantly reminded of the truth of the gospel. The disciples did, and they were with him every day. He keeps reminding us. They keep forgetting. He keeps reminding. We keep forgetting. He keeps reminding. There's a narrow path that's hard and marked with suffering, but I've overcome the world. We need constant reminders. This is why we have a gathering at church, and we have a visitation with each other in the fellowship. And friends, the promise of Christ's death and resurrection, that is the life for us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Way to go, Terry.
Sing a little verse and chorus of Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus.
Cindy heard my preparation all day yesterday. One thing is the fact that faith doesn't make things easy, but it makes things possible.
Amen.
Please think. See these words. We go forth today from this place of worship. Amen.